Good morning once again. Good morning. I have greet you here too, but it was kind of crazy. The few of us who were here earlier, we just got lost in a space of worship. And just, I love it when pardon, the realms of earth and heaven collide, right? And the realms of God's glory just push over into the space, and you don't even know. I love that. I love not knowing anymore. I know a couple of people were surprised when I said I was coming in today. I'm not why, because my obedience to the Lord. My obedience to the Lord comes before my own family. And I'm not even shy and I'm not even afraid to say that my obedience to the Lord comes before my family, because it is the Lord who gave me. And it means I can give back to the Lord in whatever I can do. Amen. I want to be short this morning because we're going to be very practical. We're going to engage. Yes, we're going to engage with the Spirit. We're going to engage with our gifts. We're going to engage with heaven. Amen. We're going to command the Spirit, heaven, to act today. We are going to we're not just here to warm a space. Amen. But we are going to command heaven to engage with us as we engage with heaven. Hallelujah. So stay hot in the Spirit. I want a few things to say this morning. Some of you saw my video, would have seen the distress that I experienced over the last couple of weeks with the stuff that is going in our country. I woke this morning to the horrible news that one of our gay ladies, you know her, was brutally murdered. Somewhere just up the road, Temple up to somewhere near where Boro Lenzo and you stay. Raped and murdered at my life last night. One of the people, did you know about this?
Friday.
Horrible, hey?
Friday.
Not last night. Was it last night? Yeah, now what's the news this morning? Our people are really distressed. In Twisted and she was a beaten friend of Twisted. And that just brings, you know, you hear what I'm saying? That just brings the reality of what is going on. But the bottom line is, the person who murdered her was a human being. The son of a woman. The son of a family. Not just some random alien that dropped in from outer space. A human being brutally murdered at yet another human being. In this case, because she was gay. And sometimes these things have happened like fast or to whatever is silly. Now it's down the road. And I've been warning for months that all these kinds of funny things are coming closer and closer to being, and never not. All these things that we saw at a distance previously, fathers chopping off their kids' heads. It happened 500 meters away from me a few months ago. 500 meters away from me, behind the police station. A father slit the throat of his own daughter and attempted to kill his baby boy. I spoke about the pastor that was organizing the murder of the church right here in Villa Park. Young lady last year, 18-year-old, brutally slaughtered a 6-year-old and removed his organs right here down the road. We cannot, as the people of God, we cannot, as the church, we cannot, as children of God, any longer be silent in God with our happy lives, people. The enemy and the works of evil and the works of brokenness are in our face. In our face. This morning when I saw some of those posts about the young lady, what was that? Madonna. Maradona, Maradona, yes, Maradona. The young lady, she was young, eh? You could see her face, she's a baby. Imagine that family this morning. You gotta go and collect that body. Broken. Destroyed. For what? For being gay. For what? For being a little different. Human beings are doing this to other human beings. A 13-year-old killed her grandmother last week. Do you understand how crazy that is, guys? A 13-year-old. as well. Your own flesh and blood, the babies that you looked at, that you nurtured, that you put bottle in the mouth, you killed them. Do we understand that there's a problem?
No.
People of God, do we understand that we cannot just go home anymore and close our doors and watch our Netflix? No. Do we understand that evil and what we can say this war is upon us? War is here! Now in Rupert's head, we can't even ignore other people in other areas, they've been facing this for so long, now it's over, it's upon us! The enemy snuffed our kids away today, they couldn't be here, that's fine. We're going to be here, and we're going to engage actively. Because at the end of the day, I've changed the title of my message this morning. The children of God, the sons and daughters of God, must find their voices. Our voice has been, some of us will sit in the midst of nonsense happening around us, our families, our friends, and we sit there quietly. And we say, it's not my business. And you go home and you listen to your partner, or you whisper to, how can I get involved? No. We are in the decade of open mouth. We are in the decade where the Lord is actively listening to what we are about to say. The Lord is actively listening to what we are going to say, and some of us are not saying anything. There's a problem when we feel that out of respect for our family and out of respect for our friends, we can keep quiet and watch chaos going on. Our children are becoming murderers. Our children are becoming abusers. There was a grade 4 child, there was a grade 4. Grade 4. How old are you in grade 4? 9 or 10? Suspended for assaulting the teacher. Through the teacher. Did you see that teacher's face? Oh, elderly lady, I felt so bad for her. She's like, oh, this is bust up face. The child threw pins and pins, and I don't know what to do else. This is happening in our midst, guys. The same spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, Lerato, is inside of us, and we're sitting like this. The same spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is alive and well and burning to move inside of us. Amen. And we're turning a blind eye. I'm tired of seeing these things on Facebook. If you reshare it, I'm gonna chew you. Let's sign a petition to get prayer back into schools. It's the thing that I hate the most at the moment. Why aren't we signing a petition to get prayer back into the home?
Yeah.
Now we want to blame government. Oh, no, no, no. Yeah, because most of us actually learned Psalm 23 in school. Most of us learned Our Father in school. Why is that? Because the parents, the caregivers, the are finding themselves too busy to align themselves with godly principles, biblical principles of bringing up children. Yes, we do our best, and yes, sometimes the devil just gets in people and their head turns, yes, but we need to be able to sleep well at night, knowing for my niece, for my nephew, for my neighbor, for my who, I did my best. Some of us are laughing when our nieces and nephews start swearing. We giggle because it's funny, it's cute. They start hitting other children. I had a case a couple of months ago, a parent was telling me she doesn't know what to do anymore. Her child is, I think he's just 10-9, and he's stealing. Special needs child. And the parent, she doesn't know, she can't even leave a 5-man, and the 5-man goes missing. I'm like, Mama, don't come tell me that. I'm not in your home 7 days a week. I'm not the one that is with your child first thing in the morning. I'm not the one that is with your child. And she was shocked and said, no, don't come and tell me that. Who is the primary teacher of the child? Not you. Don't come and tell me that nonsense. Your child is stealing. Do something about it. What must I do? Do you see how broken the system has become? Do you see that we have put our energy, we have put our attention, we have put our well-being thoughts onto a system that has failed? Now the teacher, the school, the government, all of these other forces, what about you? Filled with the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. Now you're in government to do something about it. No, people of God, no. We've all got young people in our lives, we've all got children, we've all got, even in our communities, we've all seen them, all have them. But too many of us are keeping quiet while we see the destruction that is happening in their lives. Something that I'm going to put a stop to really soon is parents sending their children to church with other people. I'm going to. Because what is that telling their child? Mom is too tired to take you to church, so I'm going to send you with so and so and so. You might as well open the jail door halfway. Because what interest are you showing their child in their spiritual growth? Amen. Amen. And we must not become part of what, if you're watching a live stream, hear me. We must not become part and parcel of this rot. We must not become part and parcel of watching our children just fall away. Too many of our families, too many of our young people, too many of our children spend Sunday mornings in front of a TV. It's nonsense. We can have time and make time to do all sorts of other things. I saw this thing the other day, I actually think I might even share it. Sports stadium on a Saturday, packed. Mm. Packed. Sunday church is empty.
Yeah, it's true.
We've got more passion for a team and colors than we have for the presence of the Lord. We've got more passion for these kinds of things than we have for the house of the Lord. David understood the value of the house of the Lord. He even allowed the Lord through his own discretion to take his child. Because he knew that the presence of the Lord was more important than even that, because it was the Lord who used him to take his way. We've got our priorities messed up. And then when things are happening that are all crazy, we're looking for someone to blame. Or even better still now, the new method, we're looking for someone to pay. We're paying for OT, we're paying for psychologists. My colleague told me a 7-year-old, well I think he's 9 or 2 years ago, 7 years old, was about to be treated for depression. Do you know that can short circuit a person's brain? What is happening in our lives right now that our young people are becoming murderers? What is happening in our lives right now that our kids are killing their grandparents? I saw something, I think it was in America or one this week. 14-year-old shot his stepfather and his 4-month-old sibling and 4-year-old sibling. 14-year-old. People of God, you see that we cannot. We cannot not. Amen. We cannot not. We cannot just go on the way we've been going on. When you leave this meeting here, you need to find out from your brother, your sister, your niece, your nephew. Did you take your child to church today? You need to find out, are you praying with your child at night? Instead of waiting for the school to pray with you. By the time our kids get to school, they should be so played up, the fire of the Lord must fall in math class. And calculus must go boom! Hallelujah! You know what I'm saying? Why aren't we having your prayer meetings in church, in school, sorry? Because we're not having them at home. Future parents, all of you, Mrs. Poole, bless you for being there. I'm telling you now, Mimi, if your child asks for a cell phone and they're under 15 years old, don't give it to me. Amy said to her mom a couple of months ago, please give me a cell phone, my friends have cell phones. And my sister, I'm like, her and her friends are all six. Six. Why and how do her friends have cell phones? And the enemy is using all of these things that we rationalize. Oh, but it's good. At least if I'm they finish early at school, they can. Oh, nonsense. There we've got that Momo thing, that weird doll that was telling the kids to kill themselves. Peppa Pig, that on YouTube was invading, but the kids are watching Peppa Pig. Then next minute this thing pops up and tells them, do you want to be my friend? Of course, every child wants a friend. Catch your head. Catch yourself. But also, kids are killing themselves over this thing. And yet the churches are empty. And the jails are getting fuller. Amen. The churches are empty and the jails are getting fuller. Lord, what is the first scripture I gave you? Give me Deuteronomy. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. I'm speaking to you as elders. I'm speaking to you as people who have children in your life. Nieces, nephews, children in the community, your friends' kids. We need to stop this business about not getting involved. To what cost? To the cost of a young lady being murdered a couple of 100 meters away from us. Maybe if more people got involved in that boy's life, he wouldn't have done that. We don't know. But it wouldn't have hurt. These commandments that I give to you today are to be upon, not inside. Sometimes when a commandment is inside, we forget that it's there. Amen. These commandments are to be upon your heart. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. People of God, if your brother, your sister, your mother, your who is not talking to the kids about the Lord, then you do it. You do it. When they're playing, when they're about to sleep, don't just put them off to bed in a tired stupor. Make them pray before they sleep. Amen. In the morning, before they do anything else, before they even want to eat, let them pray, let them thank the Lord for a new day. We need to burn on them these cultures of the Lord, these cultures of heaven. If we start infusing heaven into our kids, jails are not going to be as packed. Our kids are not going to be murderers. The enemy is not going to get in them if they are full with the Spirit. The enemy is not going to be able to where the Lord is.
Amen.
But now we've left too many gaps. Amen.
Amen.
We've left too many gaps because we've created space for other things. Some of our kids are professional. They're experted. I don't know what is the word I can tell you. At every TV show you can imagine. I didn't know when I was growing up, I don't know when. You guys remember Loving? Those of you old enough to remember Loving.
Yeah.
When we were Loving. Yeah. And it was on prime time, 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock to office, 6 Loving was on. And my parents and my late grandma used to enjoy watching Loving. And you know when you're a child, like, you hear things and they wonder, why is mom or dad, everyone's watching the show. You want to watch! You want to watch, Sally, you know? You want to watch, so you don't want to be left alone in the room now. I had to ask permission. I don't remember how old I was. But I had to ask permission a few hours in advance. Can I watch Loving tonight? I think I was allowed 1 or 2 episodes a week. So I had to choose. And if the episode got too hot. And you know, back then it was fake kissing. It was fake kissing, guys. They turn the camera and they're telling you, There's no spice anymore that is not hot enough for our kids. But why? Because we let them sit and watch. Whatever they want to watch. We think it's cute. And then they must get to look. Get to know what? It's a pity they don't know the word of God as much as they know what's happening on the show. Our kids don't know basics, guys. Think about your family, think about your friends, like, how much and what do the kids know about the Lord? I was thinking about this this morning, and I wondered if we have more, we had more of the Lord in the life of some of these people that are filling up the jails. How different would this story have been? If we had more men and women of God taking up a mantle of parenting that maybe was discarded for some reason by their own families. Taking up that mantle because it was a heavenly mantle. And engaging with these kids. Taking time out of your TV watching, your busy life, whatever, real or imagined by you. And engaging with these kids. Most children just want attention. When we got to the point where we don't hear what attention it is. Even if we're there watching our stuff on the TV, listening to whatever, as long as we deal with it, we feel that's good enough. Sure, if that's what you've been great for you. But you get the good and the bad. Yesterday we went to do the birthing big day. It was great fun. We went with MJ and the one team. And Elijah was with us, and so was Liesl's mom. And Liesl's mom was also there trying to take photos, and at the stage he was laying there. And he was chatting, he's so cute. Oh my gosh, he's so cute. I'm just, I'm going to burst with cute. You know, he makes us cute. Oh my gosh, that little face. And then Liesl's mom takes the camera and she's shooting. I'm in the front, Liesl's in the front, she's looking out the window. And he started pulling on her. Just reaching. He just wanted attention. He just wants a little something. He wants a little eye contact. That doesn't change. That doesn't change out of us even as we grow older. But who are the people in our lives? And what attention are they giving to us and to our kids around us? Y'all know a barbershop, that movie with Ice Cube is an older movie, barbershop. No? Now, for some reason, I only watched number 3 in the week. We've been watching barbershop once a week. You know, with us old people, it takes sometimes 4 days to watch one movie. It took us 11 days to watch Tintin. 11 days to watch Tintin. It's an hour and a half. That's because most nights it's like 5 minutes and I'm gone. And I'm like, what happened? You know? Anyway, 11 days to watch an hour and a half movie. So we've been watching barbershop. Now, in the third barbershop, Calvin has a son. And then one day he starts off, the son asks him for some money or something. He says, no, if you want the money, come and work in the shop to get the money. And obviously the boy was not happy. He just stepped out of the shop and he didn't put the other one. And this young man didn't even have to ask for money. They just started giving their money. Hey, little man, how's it? Here's money for you for today. What is that? It's teaching. And they thought it was wonderful, but then obviously we know that a few scenes down the line, they wanted to do it again. And how many of our kids fall for this? Because they want attention. They want somebody in their lives to recognize them, to see that they exist. And if our parents, if our brothers and sisters and who and who and who are not doing that for their kids, then we've got to step in. Because we've got the mantle of heaven upon us. We've got the mandate of heaven upon us. So we cannot just sit by anymore and watch our kids become merchants. We cannot just sit by anymore and watch our kids just fall to the wayside, become angry, beating up teachers with pens and cases, and then blaming the school. We've got to take responsibility We want to take responsibility because Psalm 127, the Lord told us, Psalm 127 tells us no uncertain times. Children are heritage from the Lord. Children are heritage from the Lord. Now here's what I want to put to you in closing. Once a year, we celebrate Heritage Day in South Africa. Right? You know that, right? On the 24th of September, okay, sure. Once a year we celebrate Heritage Day in South Africa, but more and more people are encouraged to protect and to nurture their heritage. Am I right? And people will go through all sorts of means, be it connecting with the language, clothing, food styles. We all have that in us, you know. Like pap and spinach. It's not just pap and spinach, but it's a heritage of the Free State. Cook sisters. It's a heritage for this part. In Natal, by the way, we've got completely different cook sisters. Like ours are brown with cinnamon and coconut. They look more like a donut than a cook sister. Heritage. And each place, each region, each grouping, each whatever is encouraged. We must protect this heritage. And yet we ignore what the word of the Lord says when he says that children are a heritage. Children are something that are meant to be nurtured and protected and valued and kind of kept in this. We don't lose them, but we are losing them. Either to death or the jail.
Men and women of God. We need to find our voice.
in the lives of these young people. We need to stop allowing offense. We need to stop allowing fear. We need to stop allowing protection of friendships or family or whatever, whatever, to get in the way of us bringing heaven to earth, on earth as it is in heaven through us.
Amen.
In the lives of these children. A young man, young boy, came to our gate the other day. I heard the shouting, outside. Initially, I thought it was mommy, so I thought, okay, it's not for me. But then I realized it was Stanley. And I thought, okay, good. Anyway, the people at the back opened, this little young boy came and he's rambling off to me in Afrikaans. At first, I couldn't understand what he's saying. Then I realized he asked me, do I have any toys? And he was big. He was about 12, 13, maybe, okay, 11, 12. And he's rambling off to me, and I said, so, what do you want? And he said, no, speelgoed. I said, I've done speelgoed. And I said, I really don't have. And he said to me, please, Danny, please, just find me a toy. And I want a toy. And I felt so bad for this kid. And he looked so banged up. You know, he had like this similar hair color to Zanny's, but you could see it was dirty. Just like chopped up, and his had skin going on, and he was skinny. And his clothes, it was early in the morning, his clothes were dirty, and he had this little broken school, and he's going around my neighborhood asking people for a toy. And the burden of that became so great on me, just cemented this word that the Lord had put in my heart. We've got too many stray kids. Too many kids just running around looking for love.
Yeah.
Looking for someone to put them under their wing, man. Just looking for someone to nurture you. Just looking for boundaries. You know what our kids desperately want more than anything? They want to know a fixed bedtime. They don't want to know how much you can splash on in the bathroom and say, they want to know what time is bedtime. Bedtime is 8 o'clock and they're gonna fight you, but at least they know bedtime is 8 o'clock. They want to know what time they must wake up. They want to know what is expected of them. That's what they want, that's what they need. They don't want and need to watch Netflix for endless hours. No, they don't need that. They need to talk to their parents. They need their parent, their auntie, their granny to pick up a book and read them a story. That's what they need. Now we turn on the babysitter. They watch. We even teach them how to use the remote from the time they get their fingers to move. Through them. And we are, what did you watch? Forget asking about prayer back in school. Our kids can't read. Whose fault is it? It's your fault. Our kids know nothing. And we want to get angry when they become leaders. We want to get angry when they become abusers. Next year, this has been on my heart for about 3 or 4 years. The Lord submitted it in me this morning. Next year, we are starting our prison ministry. We are going to go into the prisons and we are going to undo what was not done. We are going to go into the prisons and we're going to remember that that is actually someone's child, neglected or not, but we're going to start some dignity. We're going to start some ministry. Because it's not too late.
Yeah.
It's not too late. If those kids are still alive, the Lord has given us the mandate to say it's not too late.
Amen.
To mentor, to parent, to love, to care, to give those kids what they didn't have.
Yeah.
Some of the mothers are in the line. The kids are calling the mother by their first name. They're calling the mother Mimi, and the grandmother, they're calling mom. The kids don't know what's happening in their lives anymore. That's what is that. That's what is that. Such confusion. Who's bringing that upon them? Us. When they notice some of us scream, others are giving them money. Shame, go buy yourself. That's what we do. No, sis. word of the Lord. We need to return to the principles of mentoring and of parenting and of caring and of nurturing that is in the word of the Lord. Give me Proverbs, please. The first Proverbs I gave you, then I'm done. Train the child in the way you should go. You could see that he wasn't getting regular bottles and all of that as he should be getting. So we started noticing as young as he is, a panic when it came to feeding time. And he would scream like the house down if we left 1 second late with his bottle. For some people that's normal. I refuse to accept it as normal. I took him last week, laid my hand in his head, and I said, I'll break that curse of lack over you in the name of Jesus. I break that curse of food panic over you in the name of Jesus. I break the anxiety that was caused by you being starved in the name of Jesus. It is over, it is done, not because I said so, but because Jesus said so.
Amen.
And he's
been
fine ever since. We've got to tackle these natural problems spiritually first. Before you send the child to a psychologist, tackle it in the spirit. Before you send him to where, tackle it in the spirit, people of God.
Amen.
Hope you're convicted. Because you must use your voice. A precious and most powerful voice. It is time to roar. I saw this somewhere in the week, so it's not my original. The time of meowing is over. It's time to roar. Some of us have been meowing. In our families, we've been hinting. Amen?
Yeah.
We've been gently suggesting. No! Greater is he that is in you than anything and anyone in the world.
Amen.
Greater is he that is in you than anything and anyone in the world. So do not live in fear. And live in power.
Amen.
Do not live in worry. And move in the boldness of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Family, what we're going to do right now, I'm going to ask the ushers if you're just able to take more. I want you to write down the families and the kids in your life that you know need some heavenly intervention. Your brothers, your sisters, your friends, your neighbors' kids. If you see, and when I say kid, I mean 17 and under. If you see that there's some children that are being neglected, that are not looked after, we're going to engage with them in the spirit. We're going to take a stand in the spirit. If you're watching a live stream, do the same. Take out a piece of paper, we're going to lay hands. We're going to declare, we're going to call forth. We're going to ask the Lord to interact and invade those people's lives and homes in the name of Jesus. We cannot have our family sitting at home anymore on a Sunday morning, guys. We cannot have our children not know ABC of our word of God. We cannot have our children not know about the power of God. Jesus' name. Write down names. No time to be shy here. We are calling on people to engage with us. We're going to move in faith. And then if you know there's that one cousin of yours that's just not looking like he's going down the life path, write down his name and her name. Your own family, your own brothers, whoever they might be, write down the name. First thing you're going to do, the second thing you're going to do, want you to choose one of those names. And I want you to commit to being more active in that child's life. Choose one of those names and commit not to me, to the Lord, to be more active in that child, that person. You know, in the olden days, we used to have God fearers. Remember that? Hey, those are some good practices. How many of you have God parents? Yeah, my mistake. No one else God parents? How many of you are God parents? You're God parents. How's that thing? Bringing God into your life? Okay. Are you bringing God into that child's life? Are you? And who else, Lorenz? Are you also God-headed? Are you bringing God into that child's life? Are you? Not really. So no, that's fine. We need to return to these practices. I know that they always seem like little silly things, but we need to make ourselves become God-parents to the kids around us. Especially if their own parents are falling off the bus. When I was living and working in America, my bosses had these twin boys. They had an older boy and their twin boys. And each of the twins had different godparents. And the one set of godparents was they were fake people. And they would take the one twin that was their godchild to church. Because Italians, they're really stupid. But you understand what I'm saying? We need to engage more, not just for one, but for all.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Are you done? So you've got a list of names of kids, families, that you just want heaven to intervene. And number two, a child or a person in your life that you are going to commit to the Lord to today. To be more active, to be a God parent, to bring some parenting, to bring some nurturing, to bring some care to that person's life. Remember that part of this movement that we are in right now of the Lord is one that highlights spiritual parenting. Spiritual parenting is not just for 5 years. Spiritual parenting is for all of those where the oil runs from. As the oil runs down, we must make sure that it doesn't stop at our feet. We must make sure that the oil continues to run down, to protect the heritage that the Lord has given us. Amen.